99.99999% of Norwegian movies suck, according to you. How about the 90s and forward? Okay. So, time for a little bit of a timeout. Have a little bit of a thought. You see, I've said the good movies now. But the truth is, 99.99999% of Norwegian movies suck! According to you. According to everybody with any taste. You see, let me quote a band. It's a Norwegian band called Surferosa, which in directly English translated would be
Surfing Pink.
Yes, Surfing Pink. And one of the people in that band said, Norway is the place where art come to die, or artistic
movement
come to die. And there's a lot of truth to that. You see,
there's a lot of bad Norwegian movies out there.
But not only movies, it's bands, it's music, it's everything. Everything! We have like Ibsen, and we have like Munch, the painter. And after that, everything Norwegian artists has made has been horrible. And
we got black metal, though.
Yeah, we got black metal. Well, I don't know about black metal. Let Doctor Dee make another podcast about great Norwegian band like that. I don't know anything. I can upload it to my channel if you want to talk for an hour or two about Norwegian death metal. I don't know anything about that, but that's true. Norwegian death metal.
Black metal.
Black metal. Death. Satanic whatever. Anyway,
Swedish is death metal, Norwegian is black metal.
Oh, it doesn't matter. The point is that, what is the point? Norwegian, yeah, in Norway, except for Munch, Ibsen, period, and death metal.
And a Norwegian comic book called Python.
Nobody cares about Python except Norway. But we'll get to that. And no, we're not gonna get to that because that's stupid.
It's genius.
Yeah, it's genius, but it's nobody cares about it abroad. Anyway, most of the Norwegian pop culture sucks.
And you know why?
Because
Norway doesn't have Arnold Schwarzenegger and Sylvester Stallone. it's more than that. I just fucking with you.
You're trying to be funny. Yeah. But the point is that the problem with Norway is lots, but one of the reasons is that we don't actually have a good cultural milieu. Because Norway, we have a very distinct class system, where you're either born into the artist in the milieu, or you're not.
Environment or community.
Yeah, I'm gonna use milieu, because it sounds better. Anyway,
can't you just use community?
No, I cannot. The point is
of
that
of course you can.
When you think about like great, quote unquote, great Norwegian directors, they are usually born into a movie family. Like I have an article hanging on my wall, but I can't remember his name right now. Do you want me to pick it up? I can.
Do you know if Harald Svart was born into a wealthy family?
No, I didn't say wealthy family. I'm not a socialist. I'm talking about
now you're dragging politics, social politics into this again.
I am talking about milieu. Milieu. And one moment, I'm going to pick the article up. Count to 10, and then I'll cut it out.
All right. I can just talk about a little bit of 90s movies for a while. You have a 90s movie called Døden på Oslo S, which translates into The Death at Oslo S. It's a pretty entertaining movie. Just check it out.
Jeg har ikke så heller fett, ikke sant? Mutteren måtte trene pantsett i de der crazy påfølgskjolene sine for å få råd til spennet. Jeg går i vannet nesten en tinta. Vi leter etter fylla, vi.
Jeg kan låse inn på håpet.
It has a cool Miami Vice reference.
Cool Miami. Yeah. I don't even know what you're talking about.
Jeg vet det høres jævla dumt at du kan prøve å henge deg på Mersa foran deg. Helt til Miami Vice-gutta, eller? Sånn omtrent. Hva er livet deler med, gutte? Vi skal bare sørge for at den drittsekken i bilen foran der skal fortelle for en dommer hvorfor han driver med mindre orienter. Ok, gutte!
Death on Oslo S is actually a good movie. I would actually add that some of the children or young adult movies are actually good.
Yeah.
Especially in the 90s. But we'll return to that. Anyway, I got an article. Joachim Trier, according to an article I read, was grown up in the movie business. And I kept it on the wall because I wanted to be a movie creator myself, and that is nepotism. That is one of the main faults of Norwegian art, is that you're born an artist and then you're supposed to become an artist, and your parents are an artist, and that makes you good. Like, we have what I call inherited celebrities, like second or third generation celebrities in Norway. You can't actually succeed because the chair, if you like, the chair of the artist is already taken by parents, the children of parents, like, who cares? Anyway, the point is, so that is why Norwegian movies and art in general sucks, is that it's nepotism. But let's talk a little bit about the different movies that sucks. So, okay, most movies in history, in Norwegian movie history, suck. And what happened was that in the 1950s and the 1960s, we had those vaudeville movies that I talked about. Life Juster, but lots of other movies too. I couldn't mention them, but it doesn't matter. The point is, they were usually comedies.
What do you think about Wam Vennerød?
Yes, well, I'm going. I am coming. I'm going to those. Just wait. Just let me finish. Anyway, during the, let's say, 1970s, 1980s, we had what I would call the political movies of Norway. The political ones. And god damn, they sucked. And you mentioned the directors. Say it again.
Wam and Vennerød.
Wam and Vennerød. They made social realistic movies, and god damn, did they suck.
They don't suck because they're social suck. Political, but because they might suck on some other levels. However, they are very entertaining, like Lasse and Geir.
Kan du snurpe en smell av litt av du maser jo som et lokomotiv?
Men hør her, vennen min. Armer og bein vokser så dritfort, siden jeg er så vanskelig i alder, vet du. I helvete.
Alle jenter har et lite høl i fitta si, som det blåser i når det går.
Nå er jeg så opprørt at noe slikt i det hele tatt er mulig! Går det virkelig ikke an å ta med silkehandsker på sånne typer?
Det er sprengkåte damer i nærheten, mann!
Skal du se på kukken, kjæringfaen?
Jaså, du beærer oss mitt besøk.
Finn! Nå må du komme før maten blir kald. Du kunne ikke tenke deg muligheten av å vaske hendene dine og greie håret ditt før du setter deg til bordet, vel? Du ser ut som en lasaron.
Det er ikke nødvendig å snakke til ham med den tonen.
Jeg skal ikke ha griser her i huset.
Hvor er Lasse?
Kan ikke du kule ned et par hakka?
Det her har ikke du noe med.
Du sitter jo bare der og jævlig. Ja.
Du skal ikke snakke til faren din på den måten der. Hvor er det?
Det var jo bare for at vi skulle ha det litt hyggelig.
Hyggelig? Er det det her du kaller hyggelig? Har du blitt sprøyta gæren? Nå har dere snylta på meg i 18 år, og så kommer du dissende med en geléklump til middagen. Fy faen, sier jeg.
Hvem har bestemt, in English, who has decided, and farewell to solidarity, and heaven and... No, that's not them.
No, but I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
Anyway, Himmel or Helvete or Heaven and Hell.
Yeah, that's not them, it's a...
No, I know, but it's still the same
then
type
you have
of a... bullshit movies.
Vent litt mer vann, da. You'll come to heaven and hell. Become an angel as well. If you have guests
nå kom jeg. Nei, jeg har ikke det. Jeg skal bare bort til Lise enn til dukken min. Mor. Far! Jeg hater deg! Ser du det?
Hva da?
Ser du dyret?
Det er ingen dyr her.
Then they have Svartere Natten, Blacker Than the Night, which can be, which basically is the Norwegian version of, watch that movie, Who is Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
I have not seen that movie, but I highly doubt it's close to Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. What did you call it?
Blacker Than the Night,
I
tried to show it to you, but you wouldn't watch it.
I think I remember some kind of like, talking in the street or something bullshit like that.
It's a domestic couple.
Oh, god damn it. Oh. Okay, so the point is, from the 70s to the 80s, perhaps even way into the 90s, we had social realistic Norwegian movies. And all of them were dramas, and all of them were supposed to be close to reality, and all of them were supposed to portray some kind of social fucking issue, usually highly tedious. Like, for instance, those Housewives movies. I think he has even dared to make a trilogy of it. You know what I'm talking about?
Those probably.
Three ugly
Nå det tango for to.
I don't remember them. Are you actually meaning
Det ingen som kan tango som hen Gunnar på Mo.
No, I'm meaning slags. Horrible women. Horrible ugly women.
That doesn't make them whore.
Det bruser hett I mitt
bror. No, I know, but I'm just being slanderous.
Yeah, but are you dragging me down with you when you're making this social political...
As
and slandering.
And we're done.
Everything
and end scene. Anyway, the point is those movies were horrible, boring. Now I'm saying this with a person who's not actually watched those movies.
I have. Oh yeah, you think about Housewives.
Yeah, I said Housewives.
Yeah.
Yes. And
I
like,
haven't watched
it's
them.
Like the story is basically like three women being naggy and horrible, and then we want to do some living, you know, because that's what women deserve. They need to in social reality, they need.
Please believe us, we are not sexist, okay?
I am sexist.
But you are?
Yes, I'm sexist. I'm a horrible human being. Anyway,
if you say so.
Yeah, you are a horrible human being if you don't love social realistic Norwegian movies, because they are filled with political messages of how patriarchy is pulling women down, and how so society is making people drug addicts, and how.
Have you watched Hotel St. Pauli, in a Norwegian exploitation movie from late 80s?
No, but you're distracting the story, because I'm trying to paint the picture of the social realistic movement of the 1970s, 80s, and 90s. Anyway. Horrible, boring, tedious movies, and filled with politically charged messages, and then we get
which is not bad by itself.
Yes,
just executed bad.
No,
and sometimes
they are bad anyway.
Intentionally committed.
They are badly executed, and they have bad, politically charged propaganda stories, but that is not the point, or that is the point. Done with that point. Moving on. Then we get to the late 90s, early 20s, and to this day. Then we have what I would call school good movies. And that is when, we in Norway need to invest in movies now. We need to be culturally aware, so we're gonna give lots of money to people.
I'm
not done yet, Dr. D! Be quiet! We're gonna give lots of money to people born into the right families, and then have them make right and good Hollywood type movies. Now, they don't actually give them enough money to make Hollywood types movies. They make movies that try to be Hollywood type movies. Now, let's mention some of those. We're gonna mention those slasher movies, you know, those with the guy in the mountains killing those teens, you know. Cold Prey in English. We need to say the Norwegian one so it seems
Fritt
like... Fritt Vilt, exactly.
That chick from Westworld.
Yes, she's in Westworld, exactly. And I've seen that first one. I think I may have seen the second one. It's like, oh my god, it's like every other slasher movie. So you have like...
Without gore.
Yeah, you know, no, I agree with you.
It has some gore in the sequel.
Not a lot. Perhaps you're right. But it's not a lot, and it's not like, it's not scary, it's not interesting, it's not explicitly interesting, like violent. It's just horribly, let's make a 1970s Hollywood, or not even Hollywood's, B-Hollywood, B-movie type American slasher movie, and it's done, okay, I've seen this movie 10 times before in Hollywood, why would I watch a Norwegian slasher movie like that? I don't know, but it's done. I call it a school good movie. A person who studied movies, seen a lot of movies, let's make that one, except people talk Norwegian.
Without gore.
That's one. And then you have like... Let me bring up another movie. I think that's a brilliant example of why a Norwegian movie sucks. Okay, have you seen the movie called Kong Curling?
No.
Oh, I remember watching that movie. I would even watch it in the cinemas. It's with one of the great Norwegian comedy actors called Atle Antonsen, which was the only reason why I bothered watching it. And I watched it and was like, okay, it's a comedy. Norway usually no comedy, I guess sometimes at least. And I watched it. It's like 1.5 hour comedy movie, and The first 45 minutes, I was completely dead inside. I was like watching the movie, and I was like, this is not funny, this is not funny, this is not funny, this is boring, this is tedious. I've seen it a million times before, I know what they're trying to do, but it's not funny! And then, suddenly I started laughing. And you know why I started laughing, Dr. D?
Because the movie was over?
No, because the movie was not funny, but I started appreciating the fact that I failed so miserably.
Oh, unintentionally comedic. You know, yes. I have to name
I know what you're trying to do, and it's a failure, but I'm gonna laugh because it's so bad. It's so bad, you're trying to be funny, but it's not funny at all. I see this. I've seen this plenty of times in American movies, but it sucks. It sucks, it's not close to the American comedy movies.
I have to mention a movie from the late 90s called Spa. Have you seen that one?
Yes.
As a Norwegian, basically Norwegian version of Menace to Society.
Oh, goddamn, it's horrible.
Both of them are funny and hilarious.
I haven't seen Menace to Society, but I've seen Spa. And I remember watching it when I was like late teens. It came out in late 90s. And I watched it with a lot of my school friends. I thought, what the hell am I watching right now? It was a hybrid between a school good movie, a social realist movie, and I watched it. It tried to be gangsta, it tried to be hardcore, it tried to portray
Oslo
as a great metropolitan filled with gangsters and dangerous people. And I thought, as a teenager, this tells nothing to me about my life.
Emil var den beste kameraten min. Og han har alltid vært det. Han er 15, og så er han jugoslaver.
It was supposed to be about Towards Me, it was a teenage movie, but I watched it and was like, this says nothing to me about my life. And I talked to my friends which watched it with me, and they agreed, what the hell were we watching? Horrible, tedious, Norwegian movie at its worst.
I think it's funny as fuck.
No, it's bad. I guess if I watched it now, I could appreciate it from a ironic, quasi-intellectual perspective. But back then, I watched it and I just thought, this has nothing to me about being young in Norway in 1919, whatever. And
so, are we going to talk about that Norwegian slasher we watched earlier?
Oh, god damn it, horrible. Well, what did you call it?
Christmas Cruelty. Norwegian title is Uhellige Jul. No, but yes. The international title is Christmas Cruelty.
Well, let's start with the positive sides. The positive sides of the movie he just mentioned was that it wasn't really a school good movie in any way. It was a B movie in Norway. Now, I want to make a little asterisk from what I just said. A B movie. All Norwegian movies are B movies, but this was a BB movie, meaning it was independent, not governmentally financed. I would guess some town original wrote the script. It was like really okay. There's like one Norwegian director that actually fits this bill. What's it called? The one that created Dösnö and all those movies.
I'm sure, is it Tommy Virkula or
something? Yeah, I think Tommy Virkula. Tommy Virkula made Dösnö, that Sami movie, what's that one called? Killbuljo?
I haven't seen it one.
I haven't seen it either. I'm just saying that in that movie he's made, and all the some stupid Norwegians seem to like it. And then he made Dösnö 2, and then he made some other movies. I think he made that Hansel and Gretel 2, right?
Perhaps.
I think he did a Hollywood movie called
Hansel. It's Gemma Atkinson. Man, she's hot!
I don't care. The point is that he actually, just like in that movie you mentioned, are independent. One of the very, very few people, and I underline that, dear audience, very few Norwegian artists that actually wasn't born into the family of artists. It obviously has some kind of inner drive to make movies. They suck! They suck! But he actually made them on their own. So forever good and bad, he actually made them on their own. And so I think would be with the same with Christmas Cruelty, is that it was obviously made by some people who just wanted to make a movie. It was a film with what I would guess was a DV camera, so at least video. And it has this horrible brown tint to everything. And the story was completely nonsensical. And horribly pointless, long-driven scenes, which I would guess people call pandering. No, not pandering. What did I call it?
Pacing?
Not pacing. But you know when you...
Exposition?
No. When you have a movie and it never ends because you have a lot of filler scenes.
Just filler?
Yes, it's filler, but it's another word for it. Stretching out the story because you have none. Anyway, lots of scenes that goes nowhere with drunken people and vomiting in toilets and all kinds of stupidity. And then a serial killer comes in and kills them all. In very, very horrible, what I would say, horrible ways. I'm going to go a spoiler here and say he rapes a woman with a knife. Ooh, it was brilliant. It's so brilliant. Because, you know, you take the worst parts of human cruelty and then you put it on screen and that's a masterpiece. No, it's horrible. But, it's horrible. But, I think it was pretty clear that it was not founded by the Norwegian government. It was the people who created it was in no way born into some kind of posh artistic family. Born with a silver spoon in your fucking mouth, you do not deserve to become an artist. You need pain and suffering. And in Norway, there is no such artist. They are all spoiled fucking brats. Born into some fucking stupid artist family telling us, oh, you know, Foucault is like a great movie maker, Bergman is a great movie maker, so you should make movies like that and talk about social realistic issues that has no consequence for anybody who actually watched them. Horrible Norwegian movies, inbred, that's the word. Norwegian movies are inbred. There are a class of artists, and nobody else gets to get into that. And if you watch the average Norwegian movie, okay, I'm gonna ask Dr. Dee to see if I'm not insane. When you watch a Norwegian movie, what's the first thing you notice when you watch a Norwegian movie?
Dude, you need to jerk off sometimes.
When you watch a Norwegian movie, what do you see? What's the first thing you notice when you watch a Norwegian movie?
It's Norwegian?
Yes, they speak in Norwegian. But who speaks Norwegian?
The characters?
The characters and actors. And who are the actors?
The
same fucking ones! Over and fucking over again! Haven't you noticed that?
Yeah, many of times.
Yes. All movies in Norway have the same actors over and over and over again. And we'll see like, oh, but Norway is a small country. We don't have a lot of actors. Well, I know some actors, okay? I know some actors. And I have not seen them in any single one, okay? So it's the same fucking inbred... Oh, mention something, I can't remember. Christopher Joner. Over and over again, another movie. Oh, he's a great actor. No, it's because he's fucking six. That's what he does. Over and over again, the inbred culture of Norway has that, oh, we did use the same actors over and over again. Over and fucking over again. Come on.
But it wasn't in Christmas Cruelty.
No. But that was an independent B-movie. I told you that. Okay, let's mention more. There are more inbred actors. Come on. The one from, you know, the one from Max Manus. What's that one?
Axel Henning.
In every fucking movie. Axel Henning. He's such a good actor. He's not a good actor. He plays the same part in everyone. But he's over and over again. Because he's in the right circles. He drinks champagne with the right actors and the right directors. And he's turning on, chipping the champagne and talking the right dialogues. Because Norway is corrupt to the core. Especially when it comes to the art. Everybody is either born into that or they have to really, really work hard and prostitute themselves to get any role at all. I know Norwegian actors, I've not seen them in a single role.
So you want to eat cherry pies with the big ones, eh?
I want to, but I'm not gonna because I refuse! I refuse to be a jerk off.
Here's to the underdog.
Yes, I am on the dog, and I wrote scripts, and I tried. Yeah. I tried, and I failed. And
but what really pissed you off about Christmas Cruelty?
I told you, the rape with the knife. Explicit and violent and cruel for the sake of being that, and it's... But, okay, again, I would say that the effects or the violence and...
The gore.
The gore and the heads and all those body parts, it seemed real. Okay, so I'm gonna go with that. There are some redeemable qualities. If you like violence and gore, I would guess like 15 to 20% of the movie is actually watchable. But a lot of it is like filler. And
because they're mostly drinking and talking.
It never gets to the point, scenes that goes nowhere. But all in all, we have to give credits where credits is due. And that movie is one of the very, very, very few Norwegian movies actually made outside of a governmentally nepotistical, class-secured, Oslo-centristic, horrible, lowbrow, artist, schoolboy, good movies. You know what I'm talking about? Norwegian movies suck! And there's a reason for that. It's been governmentally, you spew money into like this group of people living in Oslo. There's no possibility of making any moves outside of Oslo. There's no story good enough to be told outside of Oslo. Everything that's happening and is interesting in Oslo. Okay, let's mention another movie. Uro, you remember that one? We talked about it earlier.
The one with the cop, the policeman.
Axel Henning, right?
Yes.
Yes. Axel. No, no, that's not his name.
No, but... Nikolai Klevegrok.
Yeah, Nikolai Klevegrok. So we have Christopher Joner, Axel Henning, and Nikolai Klevegrok. Those three are like the basic actors, no, male actors in Norway.
I agree with some actors are overused.
It's the same. Those, there's no movie outside of those. And it's like, oh,
here are some boobies to calm you down.
Okay, fine. Just boobies. Excellent. Anyway, and then we talk about, oh, we are so progressive. We're so, this is not a fucking movie except like boring social realistic movies from 1980s that actually have women in it. No movies. There are like actors, the female actors that is used over and over and over again. Of course, in Norwegian cinema too, because if it wasn't, it wouldn't be like a nepotistic society. So there are like, well, what's her kind of woman called that we said always looks tired? You know, the one Anne. I think she's called Anne something or other. Anne.
Which movie is that?
Oh, plenty, but I know she was in King Curling and
man,
I can't remember any other movies. But it's like in 100 Norwegian movies. I don't watch Norwegian movies, but she's in everyone. What's her called? Come on, you know, she always looks tired. She has like these big puppy eyes.
Do you have other movies she appeared in?
I can't remember anyone, but she's been in all of them.
And her first name is Anne?
I think she's Anne. I'm gonna write. I'm gonna Google it now. One moment. I'm gonna Google it. Fucking hell. I'm gonna Google it. Come on, internet work, goddammit. Keep your hands off my computer, bitch. I'm gonna find out myself, goddamn pansy motherfucker. I'm gonna kick your ass.
All right, let's see who this.
Yeah, I'm working on it, bitch. I'm working on it. Okay, she's called Anne Dahl Torp. Anne Dahl Torp. She's been like in millions Norwegian movies. You must know her.
Yeah.
Always bags on her eyes. Always looks tired, worn. It's like, I've seen her when she's like...
Are you sure about that?
What?
That she looks tired?
I'm gonna add a picture on the video and people can make their own fucking judgment. But yes! She always looks tired. In the very first... Oh, she's been in Dead Snow 2. You know? Oh, what a surprise!
I haven't seen Dead Snow 2.
Not 2. The first one! She's been in Dead Snow 2! Of course, she's been in every Norwegian movie. She's been in Mestren, The Sandhammer, I don't fucking... Bølgen, of course she had to be in that Norwegian...
I haven't seen that one.
No, I haven't I don't watch Norwegian movies, but of course...
Here are some boobies to calm me down.
Okay, so look at this. It's like everything. She's been in every Norwegian movie. Lunch. Cold Down Hunter.
That's a TV show.
I don't fucking care. Nasalari Pedersen. It's like every Norwegian movie ever made has been in.
Should I call you?
No, I'm not an actor.
Oh.
I'm a director. I'm a scriptwriter.
Oh, what have you made?
Be quiet, you whore. Be quiet, you fucking whore. Anyway. So see, it's like one of those examples, of great examples, and then you have, let's see here, Kåre Conradi, Kåre Conradi, you know that guy, right? Yeah. In every fucking movie, Norwegian movie ever made.
What? No, he's not. I don't remember
it. Don't be argumentative, you know perfectly well what I'm saying. And in the 90s, it was other people, you know, same five actors over and over again. It's corrupt. The society, Norwegian art is corrupt. And that is why it fails, and that is why people they try to keep it afloat by spewing governmental money into it, but it doesn't actually have any stories worth telling. Like Bølgen, I haven't seen it, but it's just basically...
I'm tired of disaster movies, so I haven't seen it.
Yeah, that's one thing, but we're making a Norwegian disaster movie. Oh, that makes it innovative and new. No! It doesn't. I haven't seen it. But I probably guess it's not. It's not. It's gonna be the day after tomorrow with Norwegian actors. Seen that, done that, do something different, but not so different that it's completely unidentifiable to the audience, like in the 1980s and 1970s when they made social realistic movies. Make something that is actually worthwhile telling, and they don't. They don't. They tell the same stories America did, but they do it with a budget of an average American television movie. You know those television movies? Like static camera, talking, and then talking, and then another one talking, and then perhaps some kind of CGI effect. Ooh, and then talking. Nothing but talking.
How about casting Anna of Torp and Axel Henning in Christmas Cruelty 2?
Yeah. Stop mentioning that horrible movie. It's not worth mentioning at all. It's horrible. But as I said, that's the only thing good. It's obviously not. It's a B movie in Norway. It's one of those very few movies that's obviously made by people who wanted to make a movie. Why they wanted to make a movie is a riddle to me. But they made it. And the same with Tommy Virkola. You know Tommy Virkola? He made some movies.
Yeah, Dead Snow.
Yeah, I've seen Dead Snow. It's horrible. It's bad. It's bad in every way. But at least he wanted to make it. I don't know why. It's horrible. But he had something. He had some kind of passion for it. But mostly you have people born into a society. But, you know, I'm getting... Have I made my point now?
Yes.
Yes. That is why Norwegian movies suck.
20 minutes ago.
Yes, I know. I know. But I wanted to nail it in.
Yes, and you did.
Okay, so let's sum it up. Norwegian movies suck because Dr. Dee.
How do you shorten that down?
Because of nepotism and cultural classism.
So, dear audience. Do you agree with our, I mean his views and opinions?
Okay.
Leave a comment below.
Okay. What is your opinion about Norwegian movies then?
Well, they could use an improvement.
Yes, they could use an improvement.
Well, they shouldn't be too afraid to think outside the box.
No.
Don't try to. I know that... Norwegian movies and other kind of movies kind of are lagging because of the economic problems after World War II. But don't be afraid to think outside the box. Denmark can make kick-ass action comedies and stuff, and Sweden can make some kick-ass horror comedies like Let the Right One In and stuff.
I don't know. Yeah, Let the Right One In, that was a good movie.
Yeah. So don't be afraid to think outside the box.
Yes, don't think too much outside the box. And don't think too much inside the box. And if you understand the Norwegian budget, you know, you make... Don't make American...
What do you think about the Troll Hunter with all the...
That was an okay movie, Troll Hunter. Troll Hunter was an okay movie.
Yeah.
It's not, like, brilliant in any way, but it was like... They took something American and then they made it Norwegian. In an interesting way.
Yeah, and you can say it's a good. It's not just good for a Norwegian movie. It's actually a good movie.
Yes, exactly. In case I didn't make that clear, that's exactly the point. It's like it takes Norwegian ideas and then add it into an American established, you know, found footage bullshit, and then they make it something new and innovative. Troll Hunter is actually one of the few Norwegian movies I would recommend. Let me just before we finish this recording, I want to add one director in Norway.
Yeah?
Torfinn Iversen. Have you heard of that guy? Torfinn Iversen?
No, I'm not sure.
No. Torfinn Iversen is a guy I studied with.
Mm.
He was in my class in whatever I studied, doesn't matter. Arts. We got a bachelor degree in the arts, movie arts. Anyway, he actually made some kind of success.
And I can tell you that he did not fit the narrative that I have said now. He's born into a family in the north of Norway, and his passion has been clear from the get-go. And although I'm a failed director, scriptwriter, movie producer, whatever, I cannot say that he in any way deserves the disdain and hatred that I've shown to the average Norwegian movies post 21st century. He actually tries to make movies. He seems to have some kind of artistic views, and it's not my kind of movies, and to be honest with you, it's not Dr. D's either, because he's not violent and horribly morally depraved. but he tried to tell stories about dramatic things, drama movies, with I guess a slight...
But do you think it's good?
Yes. And I want to say yes, because I really want to work with him later.
But should we conclude this video? It's long overdue, I think.
No, we can talk for 15 hours more. But, okay, I agree with you. We need to close it. Am I boring you now?
No, I'm just tired. It's late.
Said that in an earlier, Dr. D and me talk about movies in TV too. Torfinn Iversen is one of and Tommy Virkola. And whoever made that movie you talked about earlier, you know, Christmas Cruelty,
yeah.
are one of those examples, very few and rare examples of Norwegian movies that is not born into some kind of class. It's Norwegian art is failing because it's corrupt. I'm really meaning that. I may have been going off rail earlier, but I really mean that we have a problem in Norway.
Need to pull some sources on that one.
You can no,
really take it seriously.
No, you just need to do some investigation on your own. I mean, if I'm wrong, write it in the comment section below. tell me how I'm wrong.
I have an urge to drive a fire truck now.
But and you do you be okay. That's that. Say it one more time, and then we're gonna quit. I have an urge to
drive a fire truck.
Yes. That's a reference to the very snappy and interesting movie called Christmas Cruelty.
I en sofa fra Ikea sitter far og denger mor. Det TV-kveld og mor har sølt litt øl på stuens bord. Far blir sterk når far blir sint, og far blir sinna når han tror at hans kone driver hor med sjefen sin på hans kontor. Det var dagens lille solstreif, hilsen Wam og Vennerød.